I always felt at ease in different roles. I have always loved my work, no matter what position I was in. I prefer objectives that are attainable yet challenging. These are the lines of our next speaker, Padma Shri, Mrs. Leela Poonawalla. Ma'am, for many years, has been an inspiration, an institution, and an influencer for every Indian. Ma'am is the first female mechanical engineer passed out from the College of Engineering School. Ma'am is also the first woman CEO of India's business history. Ma'am started off her illustrious career in Ruston and Hornsby, Pune, as a trainee engineer at the shop floor. After a 10-month stint there, she joined Alfa Laval, which was then called as Vulcan Laval, a Swedish company that today has a presence in over 35 countries in the world. During a stay in Alfa Laval, Ma'am managed to work in almost every department. She rose from being a trainee engineer to a chairman and managing director. From a trainee engineer at the shop floor, Ma'am was moved to design and drawing department, then to manager exports, services, and then as an export manager. As an export manager, she got the biggest ever contract in the history of the company, procured from USSR, today's Russia, which rewarded her to be the Deputy General Manager of Vulcan Laval. Later, Ma'am was promoted as the General Manager, Exports and Marketing. In 1986, Ma'am became the Executive Vice President of Vulcan Laval, and then, in 1987, she took over as the Managing Director. In a first visit to India as the Group CEO, Ma'am changed the company's name from Vulcan Laval to Alfa Laval. She also took over the additional responsibility as executive chairperson of Tetra Pak India Limited in 1993. In the year 2000, Ma'am resigned as the chairperson of Alfa Laval India, and today she holds directorships of many companies, including the likes of KPIT Technologies Limited, Pragati Institute Private Limited, Noble Tech PLM Solutions Limited, Private Limited, Smart Cloud Infotech Private Limited, and Tyson Krupp Industries India Private Limited. Ma'am's past directorships were associated with companies like LKM India, Hindustan Packaging Company Limited, Siacom Solutions, I2IT Institutes, Delaval Limited, and Bank of Maharashtra, etc. To her splendid career, Ma'am has many accolades to her credit. She has received Padma Shri by the President of India, Best Lady Executive by the President of India, Lady of the Decade, 1978-88, Marketing Man of the Year, Gem of India, Ma'am, to take over the podium and enlighten us with the words of wisdom. Ma'am, the podium is all yours and the pleasure is all ours.
Well, good evening, everybody.
Yeah.
I didn't know I'd be addressing such a big crowd. Colonel Balaji, you never told me. I had no clue what this function is all about. I just came the other day, I think it was Tuesday this week, when I came here for something else to discuss with Colonel Balasubramanian. And he says, Leela, you have to come this week on Sunday. I said, for what? No, you have told me you will come. One day he had phoned up for something. And he said that there is some function in the college, will you come? I said, okay, I'll see. But then he took it for granted that I will come. It's just like him. This is marketing. He is so persuasive, he makes you say yes. Institute and in very good hands. Especially since you are doing your MBA in marketing, you must learn marketing from him. Because I think his practical experience of doing marketing of this particular institute itself, I remember coming here many years ago. I think first convocation, I came here as a chief guest, and it was a reasonably small institute compared to what it is now. And it is his skill, his marketing skill, that he has managed to make this institute grow from a small institute to something which is becoming like a world-class institute. Let's give him a big hand. Well, when I was sitting with him just now before coming here, he told me to give you a talk. I felt that you guys and girls already listen to a lot of lectures from your professors, right? You must be better for listening to lectures. So what I thought, I will decide that I will leave it to you to ask what you want to know about marketing, about finance, about me, about engineering. You ask what you like and I will answer. And that way it will be an interactive session, and I will be addressing what is in your mind, what you would like to know, rather than forcing you to listen to what I want to say. So let's start, right? Yes, come on. Yes, good.
Ma'am, your journey from COMK to Akuris.
You want to know about my journey? Oh, then we need 1 year. But I can tell you a little bit. They told you while she introduced me. I started with COEP, yes. It was not easy in those days. I passed out in 67. You were not born, your parents were not born. So you can imagine how difficult it was in those days for a woman to become a mechanical engineer. I was the first mechanical engineer from COEP. And when I passed out, all the job that I could get offer for was to become a lecturer, a demonstrator in COEP. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted to be practically on the shop floor, work with my own hands, because a mechanical engineer means you should be on the shop floor. Bajajas and Kirloskars and Tatas, nobody wanted to employ a woman engineer on the shop floor. Ultimately, I managed to get a job in a multinational company, which was Rustin and Armfield, it was a British company. They gave me a job as an apprentice, a training engineer. I started with them, but soon I left that because, I don't know if I should share this secret with you all or not. On the first day I was going to work, I met my present husband. he was working there as a quality manager. And he lived very close to where I was living before I was married. And since we were to go by bus, when a personal HR manager said that there's a bus stop here, you take the bus from there, you come. I said, I don't know where this bus stop is and what bus to take. He said, okay, there's one Mr. Poonawala. We'll ask him to stand wherever you think you are recognizable. And he will take you to the bus stop. So my elder brother came to drop me at that corner. And this gentleman walks in, and my brother, I was very young, of course, just out of college. So my brother told him, please take care of her, she's very young. He told her, don't worry, I'll take care of her. And till today he's taking care of me. I don't know whether that is good luck or bad luck, but we are happy. That's all. But Rustin's had a rule that husband and wife cannot work together. And then since we decided to marry, and he was getting higher salary than I was getting, so obviously I had to quit. But luckily I found a job in Vulcan Laval, and I think it happened for the good. Because had I remained in Rustin was a British company, a rather hierarchical company. So, you would have gone probably up to a point. Whereas Vulcan Laval was a Swedish company, a much more open, transparent company, not hierarchical. I mean, any young person could dream of reaching the top. Because I think it happened for the best that I left that and I found a job in Vulcan. And as it was told, I got a very good opportunity to work in different departments. And my success actually came from my exports. My export success with USSR, it was very unique. I was able to do a great job in this country. And it is for this job, USSR, when I brought that big order that she talked about. In those days, $16 million, one order was a big order. Today, of course, everybody talks billions of dollars. But I'm talking about now, 45 years ago. It was a big order, and government recognized me for my Padma Shri because of this good business that I brought from USSR for India. Because that time India needed foreign currency very badly. And therefore, they felt it was a great achievement, and then I had no looking back. Having brought that order to the company decided that it was enough of sales, because that order value was roughly going to be 3 years execution for the company. And then they thought they don't need any more orders because now somebody has to execute. So they transferred me to manufacturing. And I think that was the best thing that happened, because I really got to know how to work with the workers, how to do planning, what to do. And that helped me a lot to become the managing director. It also helped me to get in touch with the board, the senior people in Sweden, because we had to buy a lot of material from Sweden. So it gave me a good exposure. And I could sort of show that I can handle such a big job. And then I became managing director. So simple. Of course, there were many experiences, many challenges. The challenges that you face when you are executing a business which has to be delivered in time. Just one example or one challenge I'll give you, and how it helps to keep your mind open. Why you should keep your mind open. When I was executing one of the first orders that I got from USSR, it was an order that they gave to experiment that whether we can deliver and whether Mrs. Poonawalla is capable of executing jobs. I had this order and I had to deliver 5 units, they were modules, by December. Yeah, and it was almost October, and we were trying to put these modules together. Since I was in charge of production, we were trying to put these models together, but we were just not succeeding. I contacted my parent company in Sweden. They sent one person from Sweden. They said, we'll send you someone who will help you to put this together, because we were doing this for the first time. He came in here. And we were executing this in Satara. Now in India, we are used to working in open workshops. Yeah, we did not have a closed factory. We had an open workshop, a shed, where we were trying to assemble. This guy came, Swedish guy. He had never been out of Sweden. He came here and he worked there 3 days. He packed his bag and says, I cannot work here. There's too much dust here. How can I work? I cannot work here. I said, I'll talk to your boss. He will throw you out. He said, I don't care. I'll lose my job, but I cannot work here. I'll die here. So he left. I was just, in the old drums as to what should I do. I was sitting in my office. In came a supervisor. His name was Karnal Singh. He had just returned from Thailand, where I had sent him for doing some project work. He came in, locked my door. He had come to get his TA bill approved. He came in and he brought in bill. Ma'am, I want you to sign the bill. I said, I give it to you. I signed it. I gave it to him. But he was not ready to go out. I said, what do you want, Karnal Singh? He said, no, madam, aapko abhi aise kabhi dekha nahi hai. You're sitting so dejected. What is the problem? I said, tere ko kya karne ka hai? Because I thought he's a supervisor. I'm an export manager. Tere ko kya karna hai? Bola, sorry, ma'am. Main work to hoon to chota aadmi. Lekin aapko aise udaas dekh ke mere ko bahut kharab lagta hai. Aap zara kuch batayenge mujhe, to maybe I can find some solution. It just struck me. Then why not? I mean, I can't go to my managing director and share my problem, because he'll tell me you're failed. This guy is not going to tell me you're failed. He'll at least listen to me because he's junior. Correct? Like you all listen because I'm talking. Not necessarily that you want to listen. So I said, okay, sit down, I'll tell you. And I told him, this is what it is, I have to deliver, and we don't know how to do it because we have to assemble the modules, then we have to dismantle them, we have to mark them, we have to send them. These 5 modules have to go in December, without which we won't get the next order. So he said, I'm a small man, but you're handling this job totally wrong, you're handling it rubbish. I said, what? Karnal Singh, kiske saath baat kar rahe hain? Haan, main madam, aapke saath baat kar raha hoon, aap export manager hai, lekin, aap ji job handle kar rahe hain, bilkul galat handle kar rahe hain. I listened to him. He said, this job is to be assembled like you assemble at site. A module is to be assembled at site. You are assembling this module as you are working in a factory. Your factory workers don't know how to handle such jobs. You give this job to people who are working at site, they will know how to do it. It really struck me. Karna Singh, you will do it? Yes, I will do it. You talk to my boss because he was reporting to somebody else. So I went and talked to his boss and I pleaded with him that give me Karna Singh for a couple of months. And that was the turning point of my career. I actually give my credit to Karnal Singh for getting me the managing director's job. Because he took over. You see, we had to assemble this. There was a separator, there was a heat exchanger, there were pumps, they all had to be put together. They had to be nuts, bolts, tight, T's, bends, they all had to be assembled. You would go there, one bend is missing. I don't know where to get the bend. Again, go to Pune, bring a bend. And this way you were not able to do it. But this guy knew exactly because working at site, I don't know how many of you know anything about how a project is put together at site, but when you're working at site, these are things that happen every day. They know exactly how to manage. They know exactly from where to get the things done. He managed to do it and we delivered 5 modules in December. And I tell you, that was the beginning of my success in exports. Because I kept this promise that I had told them I will deliver, that's what gave me the $16 million order. So what I'm trying to convey to you is that from this I learned a lesson that at any level in your career, at any level in your life, you should keep your mind open. You don't know who is going to be able to give you a solution to your problems. You don't know who is going to be able to guide you to your destination. You listen, become a good listener, listen to everybody. Don't think that you know it all. I thought I knew it all, but I did not know. And I learned this lesson. And since then, any idea comes from anywhere, it is to be evaluated before it is thrown out. Never crush a flower without taking the fragrance of it. Okay, I hope I answered your question. Come on, some more.
Ma'am. Ma'am, here, the comparer.
Where are you?
Ma'am, here. Towards your left. Towards your left.
Ma'am, I have a question. No, I'm looking there.
Ma'am, in one of your interviews, you have mentioned that when you were first given an interview for the shop floor manager, they asked you a question of if somebody winks at you, and you replied back that I'll again wink back to the same person. So that was an unusual answer. Apart from this, again in the same interview, you mentioned that when you're dealing with your Russian counterpart and he asked, don't you feel cold? And you replied back saying that we as an Indian have very warm heart and so we don't feel cold. So these are the unusual answers that you gave in a very important interview. We are on the verge of campus placements. Within 1.5 months or so, we will be giving facing interviews. So my question is, what do you think we as a student of MBA, if we give such kind of unusual answers in interviews like that, will that be helping us or will that create, different...
This you're the big disadvantage. Imagine you answering, I'll wink back at you. Supposing a panel of ladies is sitting there to interview you and you say, I'll wink back at you, what will happen to you? Aren't you feeling cold? You say, no, my heart is very warm. You see, I tell you, I had a big advantage to be a woman executive. As a woman engineer, I was unique in my time. Of course, now there are many, but in my times, I'm talking about 45 years ago, when I started work, I was unique. And people were ready to listen to me. They were interested to hear what I'm saying. Yeah? And they would look at it differently. Now, it is different. If a girl now answers like this, probably it will not be viewed very, very effectively. But I was coming and they had no experience whatsoever how to handle me. So I could say anything and get away with it. So when this personal manager asked me, because I wanted to work on the shop floor. I said, I want to work on the shop floor. And they were very worried that if I go to the shop floor, how will I behave with all the workers? Because there were no women there. There were no toilets for women. Even now there are not. But that's different. But it was, they were worried. So they asked me this question. Now, I had to put their worries to peace. They don't worry, I know how to make friends with them. That's what I really meant. And they understood that. When he asked me, the personal manager, what will you do if the worker winks at you, if you are on the shop floor? I said, don't worry, sir, I'll wink back at him. Because if I come back to you and complain to you, you'll throw me out. Because it's easier to throw one girl out than to throw all the workers out. So it was logic that I explained to him. And I think this is what they understood and appreciated, that I know how to get along with people. I intend to get along with people, I intend to adjust myself with people and not become a bottleneck in just bringing complaints. And when I talked about this warm coat, I had gone to USSR. First time when I went to USSR, it was in December, minus 20 degrees temperature. Yeah. And in those days, Indians were not still traveling so much. So we did not have many warm clothes here. All that I could get was a thin leather coat from Bombay. Yeah, I took that and I had gone. It was freezingly cold, minus 20, you can imagine. And I went to this minister of meat and dairy in USSR, because that was the first meeting to start with, because we were producing dairy equipment. So I had to meet the minister from food and meat and dairy. So I went to his, and he looked at me and he thought that I should be shivering. Yeah. So he out of concern told me, "Madam, aren't you feeling very cold? How will you survive the balance days here?" So what should I tell him? That my India doesn't give me any warm cold? If I tell him that, he'll say, "You go back to India." There's no point, no? So I told him, "No, I'm not feeling cold at all, because I'm coming from India. We are all warm-hearted people in India. So we don't feel cold. We are coming from India. Indians are warm-hearted people. So I'm not feeling cold." He also understood what I'm trying to say, that please don't ask me this question, because we don't have warm clothes in India. We are warm people. Luckily, he had an assistant whose wife, he said, "Your wife's size must be same like Mrs. Poonawalla. You please lend her, borrow her, your wife's coat for the time she's staying here." And that gave a message to my company that they jolly well buy me a nice coat. And that's how I got my mink coat from Sweden. I still have that coat. Although I can't wear it now, because Mehka Gandhi will kill me. Mink is an animal. Yeah, it's a mink coat. I have it and I treasure it very much for memories. So it will go into my museum when I will be doing the museum in another 2 years. Yes, sir.
Good evening, ma'am. Well, first of all, we all are glad to have you here in SBS. Ma'am, you have been such an amazing journey till now. Being a first mechanical engineer to Padam Shri and now the owner of many industries. Ma'am, I wanted to know, this was a real aspiration, or it was just a matter of luck or flow of the time? Or this was a real aspiration, what you're living right now?
No, it was not an aspiration when I started as an engineer that I want to become a managing director. None of you should have such aspirations. You see, you have to go step by step. When you are going to go out into the world to start a job, your first aspiration should be to get a job. Second aspiration should be to get confirmed in that job. Third aspiration should be to get on to become a confirmed manager in that company. So you go step by step. If you go out in the way that I'm going to look for a job which will make me a managing director, you'll get frustrated. You'll get frustrated because it's not easy. Life out there is not easy. There is big competition. And if you do that, you will miss out on the joy of small steps that you will take in life. Enjoy those small steps. I enjoyed every step that I went through in my life. When I got the first job, I was so happy. Yeah. Then I was training engineer. I was looking to, I hope God they confirm me. I hope they confirm me. I got confirmed. I was so happy. After that, it was that, okay, I got confirmed now. How can I get a position as junior engineer? So every step, gave me happiness, gave me joy. It was only when I became the vice president that I dreamt that, yeah, I think now I'm ready to become the managing director. Now let me aspire for managing director. And then every time I made a step forward, I celebrated. You guys, I do not know how very well celebrate your successes. Every small success that you achieve, learn to celebrate. Celebration doesn't mean that you have to drink beer and champagne. Celebration can also mean you can have vada pav. Because this is what I used to do. See, I was a planning engineer. Once my boss called me and told me, "Leela, from tomorrow, you are going to go into sales." I said, "But I don't know anything about selling." "You will learn. You will learn." So he gave me a position of selling pumps. Alfa Laval used to make pumps that time. And he says, "You have to sell 1,000 pumps in the coming financial year." I said, "But the previous guy who was in sales was selling, was given a target only 500. Why are you doubling my challenge?" You know what he told me? I think you have the capacity to do it. Now he had so much faith in me, so I had to do it. I broke down that 1,000 pounds. If I would have said, 1,000 pounds achieve karna, 1,000 pounds achieve karna, 1,000 pounds achieve karna, I would never have achieved it. I calmly, quietly broke that down. I don't know how to sell, so first month I will sell only 10 pounds. Second month I plan to double it by 20. And then I kept on tripling it. I made a plan. Planning is very important. And then I went about selling. First month I sold 15 pounds instead of 10 pounds. I was so happy. I told my whole department, we were all, you know, young people there. Hey, come on, let's go and celebrate. Hey, kya celebrate kar rahi hai tu? Maine 15 pounds sell kiya. To kaun sa bara share mara? That's what my colleagues told me. To kaun sa bara share mara? Tune nahi mara hoga, maine mara hai. Nothing to me, it means much, because I had set a target of 10 and now I sold 15. I have achieved a goal that I set for myself. Now you want to come to eat vada pav in the canteen or not, I'll pay for it. Of course you'll come. All of them came. Who won't come for free snack? So, and you know, this way, if you celebrate your successes, your small goals that you achieve, yeah, you are creating not only joy for yourself, you are creating joy for others. You are creating awareness about others. You are trying to tell others that I am a happy person. I am happy, I am achieving my goals. Then only others come to know that you had some goals. And this is how every time in my life I have done that. I started my scholarship program, first year, 20 years ago, I started with 20 girls. Last year we gave 1,000 girls scholarship. And this is how it is. And already I have got 1,700 applications. I hope I'll be able to cross 1,200 this year. And this is how it is. And this makes me happy. Small steps ahead make me happy. I started with post-graduation. Now there are totally 12 streams that we are giving scholarships on. In school program, I started with 4 or 5 schools. Today we are working with 15 schools. So this is how step by step, if you keep doing, celebrate, enjoy. Enjoy life. You'll go through this life only once. It's up to you whether you want to make a happy life or you want to make a grumpy, sad life. Decide for yourself. Decide that I will be happy, I will enjoy what I'm doing, I will enjoy the achievements. Don't bother what others are saying. Always also motivate yourself. Be a self-motivator. Don't look for motivation outside. If it comes, it's good. Somebody says, Shabas, Lila, I feel happy. But I always told myself, I've done good. I'm great. Yes, I am great. I get up in the morning, till now also I get up in the morning, I tell myself, you are the best. You are the best and you will have the best day today. See, if you are not going to appreciate yourself, why the hell should the world appreciate you? So learn to appreciate yourself, learn to tell yourself that I am the most handsome guy, learn to tell yourself I am the most beautiful girl. And you are unique. Each one of us is unique in this world. There is no other Leela. भगवान की लीला हूँ लेकिन और कोई लीला नहीं है. Don't get dejected if somebody, if your boss doesn't give you shabasi, don't mind, it's his business. He's a sad fellow, he's an unhappy fellow. Yes, any more? What about girls? How come girls are not asking me any questions?
Good evening, ma'am.
Hello.
First time in my entire life, I'm listening to a speaker who is awarded with Padma Shri. Ma'am, how you felt when you received this award from the first citizen of India? Now I want to know your feeling and ma'am, think of motivation that we also can receive this award in future.
Goals, as you have said, rewards come by themselves. They come when they are ready to come. If you run after them, you will never get them. I got even an award from the King of Sweden. I didn't ask him. But they, Sweden appreciated the work that I did with USSR because it was a Swedish company. And when I got this big order, $16 million order from USSR, a lot of equipment we bought from Sweden because we were not making all the high-tech equipment in India. So we got a lot of equipment from them. Sweden was so happy that they could earn so much million dollars that they awarded me a Polar Star Award by the King of Sweden, naming me as the first. Focus on your goals, you focus on your work, you focus on the task in front of you. Do it and do it passionately. Be passionate about the work that you are doing. Don't just do it. No, I'll do it. Even if you don't like it, sometimes it so happens that we get some assignment which you don't like. Yeah? Either you quit or you passionately work for it. Change it to I have to I want to. Many times, you know, you may have to do something because it's the need of the day or you need to work in a particular company for your financial reasons or whatever it is. So you have to do it. Change that have to want to. Get up in the morning and say, I want to go to work. I want to do this. And you will believe it or not, you will be so much more effective in doing your task if you change your have to want to. Be passionate. Be passionate about your studies also. You must be, I'm not saying you're not, but even if you are, improve on further. One step ahead. Yes, now one last question from a girl, come on.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
My name is Anusha Jain. Ma'am, I need to ask that, as a first lady, you are a mechanical engineer, and at many places you were the first lady. So you might have faced many problems. Many people might have ignored you or demotivated you for your job, or they might have said that you can't do that. So how you overcome with all these words and how you progressed after that?
See, I really have faced no problems at all because I don't look at problems as problems. I look at them as opportunities. For him, he used to sit in the balcony and he used to read the newspaper. We made a deal. I make tea. You read the newspaper and tell me all the news so that I don't have to read the newspaper. Period. You must try to find and have no egos. You will get along very fine in life. Okay, any more questions? We have about 5 minutes more. Yes?
Ma'am, do you think that we need to have allocation, that seat allocation for women, or we need to appreciate the talent despite of the gender?
I really don't believe in reservation. To be person oriented rather than gender oriented. If the person is intelligent, if the person is good, if the person is willing to give what it takes to make their job successful, and he or she should be given that position. It's nothing to do with reservation. Reservation only creates weaklings rather than successful people. Because we just take it for granted. Gender reservation, I don't believe in any reservation. There should be no reservation. You should give equal opportunities to everybody. Don't say because she's a girl, we will not consider her. You must consider her for what her, he or she is, rather than because she's a she or he's a he. Become a person-oriented society. And it's out, all you young people, when you're going out into the, soon you will be qualifying yourself and going out into the business world. Practice this belief that we are a person-oriented society and not a woman or a man-oriented society. Carry this with you. You all have to change the next generation. You all have to change the country. We have done our job.
Ma'am, one last question.
Okay.
Ma'am, we ladies, especially girls, are very emotional. So sometimes they get demotivated with small little things. They don't share it with others, but they do. So ma'am, who is the person who keeps you motivated or who boosts up your motivation every time you get demotivated?
See, we are. God has made women, men, men. They say, no, men were made in Mars and something to do with the Venus. You do get emotional. I also, if my husband just shouts a little, I cry. There's nothing wrong with it. You're a human being. Yeah? And okay, if this happens in the work, you can't cry there. Go home, look at yourself in the mirror and cry it out. No problem. And remember, the best helping hand is at the end of your own arm. Learn to help yourself. Learn to help yourself. At that moment, you're emotional. Keep it. Don't talk. Don't react. Calm down. Cool down. Go home. Go to the bathroom, cry, put in the mirror, finish it off. Start the day, next day, a new day. You will find that this works. You don't have to worry because I'm a woman, I can't cry. You can cry, men also cry. Yes, they pretend not to cry, but they cry, I know that. They are equally emotional. Only thing is, you know, boys to boys share much more equally everything than girls share with the girls. girls sharing with girls, they consider girls more competitive rather than collaborative. Boys are more collaborative. Boys have more comradeship among themselves. They're more collaborative, they're more comrades. They come together more effectively. Girls don't do that. Girls still find a little bit of competition within each other. So we need to change that. Each one of us got our place on this earth. We don't have to worry. Each one will get their own position. So become more collaborative. And you will then find that you have someone to whom you can talk, and you don't need a psychiatrist. You can become each other's psychiatrist. Okay? Shall we close? No? Okay, one last one, yours, white shirt.
Ma'am, I just want to know, we all know your successes. I just want to know, just one failure will change your life.
Oh my God, I don't have any failure. I have to just say OMG, the new picture that's come, oh my God. I have not had any failures. You see, again I come back to it. I have never really looked at any setback as a failure. Setback has been a part of life. Like when, I don't know whether you call that a failure, I converted it into success. I was a mechanical engineer, right? I went to join Alfa Laval as a mechanical engineer. One fine morning my boss calls me, said, you forget about your planning, engineering, design, everything. You're going to be in charge of plant maintenance. Plant maintenance means what? Painting, sink cleanliness, sweepers will report to you, gardeners will report to you, toilet cleaners will report to you. I said, what kind of job is this? I'm a mechanical engineer. He says, well, this guy has resigned and we don't have anybody else to replace. I said, are you giving this to me because I'm a woman? He said, I don't know about that. This is the only job available just now. I was very upset. I went home and I cried. As usual, I must cry, no? So I went home and I cried. I told my husband, look at these guys, how they are treating me. They are saying that you look after now this job. I'm a mechanical engineer and they are telling me to look after painting, cleaning, toilet cleaning, gardens. What is this? He gave me one very good advice. He says, Lila, see, you have a job, right? Either you do the job, what the organization has given you, and enjoy doing it, learn from it, be happy. If you don't like it, leave it, come home and sit, find another job, and if you don't get to sit at home, you will still get food from me. But don't be unhappy. Don't grumble that why I'm doing this. This is unfair to me. Whatever comes your way, take it as it comes, take it as it is fair and it's meant for me. Next day I went and I told my boss, I will take the job. And believe me, that job taught me so much. Taught me so much of what Swachh Bharat is all about. since then, you know, Alfa Laval kept on getting the best. I don't know, none of you of course would be there, but maybe Colonel Bala might be remembering. Alfa Laval used to get the best governor's trophy for the best gardens maintained because I was in charge of the gardens. I learned so much from those supervisors. I used to go to the workers' gents' toilet taking union leader with me because I couldn't go there alone. But they appreciated so much. They started to love me because I was so sincere about the work that I'm doing. And therefore, when I really became the managing director, I got such good cooperation from my workers. It's they who made me successful, not me. And this all came because of my being, involved with their activities in this particular job. I got very involved with them. So, and I introduced that, liquid soap. I went into the workers' toilet, you had those cakes, soap cake. It used to be much, you know. I said, how can you wash hands with this? So I introduced liquid soap, that turning around and... It was the first company which introduced in workers' toilet liquid soap. And they were so heartbreaking. These are small things in life. When you're talking about them now, you feel what man is talking about. But when 40 years ago, liquid soap was supposed to be very elite people's product. But they were so happy that man trusts us with this and is giving us good facilities. So they learned how to keep the toilets clean. Okay, thank you very much and wish you all the best.